Welcome to this episode of Let's Talk Tech. Today's programming is brought to you by UBC Gearing Up Engineering Outreach, an organization in which we bring the joys of STEM to youth all around BC by hosting clubs, camps, cool events, and now online content. We have two activities planned for today. For the first activity, we will be using block coding to warm up our programming knowledge and program a sorting hat using the Adafruit Circuit Playground. For those who are up to the challenge, we will then be transitioning to JavaScript to edit our code. The second activity will have a short teaching tutorial, but the rest will be self-guided. You will get to use the JavaScript knowledge you gained today to try out some different coding challenges. All right, so let's get started. So, Circuit Playground, Sorting Hat, what are we talking about? So the Circuit Playground is a physical programmable board with sensors, buttons, LEDs, speakers, and other cool things. Since this is an online session, we don't have the physical Circuit Playground boards for you to use, but we will be using an online emulator which is able to do all of the same things. The sorting hat. If you've watched or read Harry Potter, it is the hat that sorts you into your different houses or groups at the very, very beginning of your time at Hogwarts. So if you have not watched Harry Potter, I have a short snippet of the video to show you how the process works.
When I call your name, you will come forth. I shall place the sorting hat on your head, and you will be sorted into your houses. Hermione Granger?
Oh no.
Mental, that one. I'm telling you.
Ah, right then. Right. Okay. Gryffindor!
Draco Malfoy.
Slytherin!
That's not a witch.
So hopefully for those who have never heard of Harry Potter before, that was a good way to understand how a sorting hat works. Now, how will we make our own? So one very important thing is that before any sort of coding begins, the programmer must plan out their program. They don't have to draft everything out, but they should first break their program into smaller steps. So what are the steps that take place when the sorting hat sorts everyone into their houses? So we have sorting hat is placed on the person's head. It decides on which house to sort them into, reveals which house they now belong to, and then the person walks away and a new person steps up. And then we repeat this process over and over again until everyone is sorted. So with this information, something that we have to do is to draw a flowchart. Programmers use something called a programming flowchart to plan out their program. A programming flowchart is a diagram that uses certain shapes and symbols to represent a sequence of coded instructions. There are four basic symbols. The rectangle, which symbolizes start, or the very first step of the program. A rhombus, like this. Is a process. It is a series of actions or steps. It is an event. After that, we have the diamond. The diamond is a decision. It is the action of deciding or checking the conditions of something, so it will have different paths depending on what decision it makes. And finally, the fourth basic symbol is an oval. So this marks the end or the result of a process. There are programs that exist to help you draw these out, but you can also do it by hand. No coding language is required during this part, and you can use plain English or whichever language you prefer to plan it out. Although sometimes using inequalities and equations can reduce the number of words you have and make your flowchart look a lot more organized. I'll give you some time right now to plan out your own, and I will also draw my own on here, but I will fast forward through it so you won't see me struggling with drawing shapes. But let's go. So here we have my final product. It's not the most beautiful flowchart in the world, but it gets the message across. You can see each of the steps I have drawn out here. So the first step, the start of our program, is when the hat is placed on the person's head. I decide to indicate this with a button press. And then the next step is our first decision, or I guess our only decision. From the outside is what it seems. So the decision is to decide which house to put the person in. So if you break it down, it's actually a few smaller decisions in a way. So first, it's like the hat asks, should I put in Gryffindor? Yes or no? Nah. Maybe I'll do Hufflepuff. Yes or no? I don't know. We'll see. Maybe Slytherin. And so on. Well, we know that that's not necessarily how it makes the decision, but this is a way that the decision could be made. So I decide that might as well signal the house by changing all of the LEDs to the color of the house. So that is the process of revealing which house the person should go to. Now the person goes to the table and the hat is placed on the next person, and we can start the process again with the click A. All right, so now that we have our general process figured out, yours doesn't have to be the exact same as mine, but as long as it is able to work, that is good. We are able to move on and start our program. So as I mentioned, we will be using the Adafruit Circuit Playgrounds, and that is on the website over here, makecode.adafruit.com. So you're going to go to that website and create a new project. So first I will show you a demonstration of the program that I made for my sorting hat. Yours can be a little bit different, a lot fancier if you want, or customized a lot more, just however you want to do it. So I made a little startup sequence where it displays the different colors and then makes a sound that indicates, okay, the hat is awake and ready to work. So we press A to randomize this, and shake to activate. And so the first person is in Hufflepuff. Now that person leaves, another person comes, we press A, and then we shake. Thinking, and it's Ravenclaw, and so forth. So this is my program, and now it'll be time to make yours. When you create a new project, you will end up on a page that looks like this. So there are different categories on the side, each with different blocks of code. If you have never used this program before, I would recommend you to pause the video, take a few minutes and explore all these and play around with them a bit to see what they do. And if you are done with that, or if you don't want to, we can get right started. So the first thing I'm going to do is to create a variable called house. So a variable stores information, and in this case, it is going to store the house that we're going to be sorted into. So now, as I mentioned, when the hat is placed on a person, I want to click on A to signal that. So I will drag that from the input section. Now inside there, I will set my house variable to 0. So far, this doesn't really seem to mean anything. That's okay. Okay, so now what I will be doing is going into the math section and grabbing the pick random and putting it in this white circle over here, and replacing the 10 with a 3. So now I am setting the house to be a value between 0 and 3. So why 0 and 3? So with programming, everything begins with the number 0. So instead of starting from 1 and counting 1, 2, 3, 4, we count from 0 and go 0, 1, 2, 3 to signal 4 different options. So right now we have house 0, house 1, house 2, house 3. Okay, and so just having the button click currently does nothing. So I want to shake my hat to let it know to start thinking and doing things. Okay, so this is where the decision happens. From my flowchart, that was where the decisions broke off into a bunch of the smaller decisions. And that is going to be shown with our if-else statements here. So I'm going to expand it using that little plus button so that I now have the word else 3 times and the word if 3 times, but there's a total of 4 different branches. So it works exactly the same way as it sounds in English. So if something is true, then you do something. If not, else, you check if something else is true, and you do that, and so forth, until you run out of options and you just do whatever is left. So right now I am going to be dragging the comparison operator 0 equals 0 into each of these. Okay, like that. And now I want to put my house variable. That was not what I wanted to do. Yeah, sometimes block coding is annoying. Things don't quite fall into the right place. You put house into the first white circle of each of those operators. Okay, so now I have house equals 0, house equals 0, else if house equals 0. We don't want it all to be the same house, so I'm going to change this to 1 and 2. So if it is house 0, we're going to do something. Then we're going to check if it's house 1 and do something. If not, we'll check if it's house 2. And if not, by default, it can only be house 3, and so we don't have to write that in. It would be a little bit extra. Okay. Now, to signal that, to display our house, the color of our house, we need to light up our LEDs. So something else I want to do, because just turning them all on at once is a bit boring, is I want it to go in a little circle, as you saw in my example one, light up one at a time to make a cool little animation. Okay, so I'm going to be using this, the for index from 0 to 4 loop. So I'm going to drag one of these into each of these branches of my if-else statement. Okay, there we go. And we're going to change the number from 4 to 9. So this is because we have 10 LEDs, and as I mentioned, everything starts from 0. So right now we have for index from 0 to 9, which is our 10 LEDs. Okay, so now I'll be going to the light section, scrolling down and finding this, set pixel color at 0 to red. I'm gonna put that here. I'm tired of dragging blocks, so I'm just going to copy-paste it and drag it a little bit faster than scrolling through. But in case you're wondering why my code blocks are just popping up, that's why. I'm just copy-pasting. It's, you know, shortcuts. Okay, and I'm going to change these colors to match the Hogwarts house colors. So red for Gryffindor, yellow for Hufflepuff, green for Slytherin, and blue for Ravenclaw. Okay. There we go. So If I just run the code right now, we won't really be able to see the animation because it is way too fast. So something else I need to do is to use this little pause thing over here. So you can change this number around, but it is in milliseconds. So 1,000 milliseconds make up a second. So right now it would take 1 second for it to go around the whole thing. Okay, so I'm gonna place each of these here. My code is getting very long. Okay. So now what do you think would happen if we tested out our code right now? Well, you can't really answer me, so I'll just show you what happens right now. So right now, oh no, we only have one that lights up. That's not right. Why is it happening? That's because we have our block over here set pixel color at 0 to red. And that number is not changing. We're still at 0 the whole time, even though we looped through it 9 times. So what we need to do here is to go into our variables, and wow, a new variable got created for us, index. We can put that over here. So something funny about this program is that sometimes when you drag out the for loops, it will create new index variables for you. So you'll have index, index 1, index 2, and that was what it did for me last time. But this time it didn't, so that's good. If it does for you, don't worry about it. Just make sure you have the numbers matching up, or else it'll be a little confusing. Okay, so now if I shake, yay! We can check to make sure that we're able to randomize by clicking A, and we are. So that is very good. Okay, so now we have the basic functions of our sorting hat. But we want to make it a little cooler, a little more streamlined. So also, this huge long chunk of code is a little bit annoying to me. So what we're going to do is we are going to make a function. So I'm going to go over here to advanced, make a function, and I'm going to call it spin, or spin light. I guess. Okay. So now that's up there. And I will plunk that over here so I can see it a little better. Okay. So for this function, what I want it to do is I want it to cycle through each of the colors so that it seems like the hat is thinking. In addition to that, I do want it to start with white, so that whenever this function is run, we will always be able to see that. So it starts with white. It doesn't just stay at whatever color. If we finished with red and it starts with red, we don't get to see that red animation and we go straight to yellow. So this is just so that we can see the full animation. Of course, that is up to you whether or not to do something like that, but this is just my example. Okay, so I'm gonna copy each of these for loops, since they do exactly what I want, into my function. I'm not going to copy the if statements because I want all of these to run. Okay, so the if statements were for when I am displaying a certain house. So click that here. Oh, there it is. And there we go. So one important thing to note is to make sure that your for loops are not inside of each other. So not like this, that'd be terrible. You want them to be outside, one after the other. Okay. So now I have a function and I am going to drag this block out, so it's the call spinLights. So now when I click on the A button, the first thing it'll do is to randomize the house, and then it will spin the light. So let's take a look at that. Click button A. Yeah, we got to see the animation. We did see the lights all start as white, and I think I should probably add a little delay after that as well. A little pause so that we can see it for a little bit longer. But I'll just set it at 200 milliseconds. So it's a little bit shorter. Okay. So, yeah. You can put the function anywhere else if you want as well, so it doesn't have to be just, it doesn't have to be after you randomize it. It can also be when you shake. I think in my original example, I put it at the beginning of on shake, so that when I shook it, it would cycle through and then make the decision. So right now, cycle through, yellow, green, blue, red. So we know that we're in Gryffindor. Okay. But one problem that we might come across is if we were to get Ravenclaw, which I'm currently not getting, it will look like it's just stuck on blue and not changing. Okay, well, I'm not getting that example right now, but you can imagine it. So there are a few things I can do to remedy that. One is to make another one of these and change it all to white, which was what I did in my example. So I will change all of these to white before making the final decision. But another thing I could do is when we want it to make its decision, we can get it to make sounds with music. Yay! So I'm gonna play the budding sound after it spins the lights. And I will, what should I do with this? Oh, I should probably change the volume because I don't want to go deaf. So I'm gonna plunk that over here and I will set that as an onStart function. So an onStart function is just a function that sets up everything at the beginning of your program. It runs once and then you don't have to worry about it. So that's where I'm gonna set up my volume. I'll just set it as 10. So it's not as loud. Okay. And if you want to do my little startup sequence as I did in my example, I can put the call spin lights in the on start as well. So now if we start our program, it should automatically spin the lights and end up on the white. Okay, and if we shake, now we are able to hear a sound before it displays our house color. Okay, so that's pretty much the main structure of this. Feel free to play around for a bit, make it more fancy, add some cool stuff to it. But yeah, take a few minutes and I will show you how to. Oh, actually, let's just go straight ahead, because this is a video. I keep forgetting that this is not a live event. So, yeah. So up here we see this toggle switch, blocks and JavaScript. So what you can do is you can switch over to JavaScript. Okay, and now you see this whole chunk over here of code. And it doesn't look that pretty anymore. It's so long and it looks so repetitive. It seems like the same thing over and over and over again. And I don't really like that. So let's talk a bit about why there is block coding, but also there is coding like JavaScript and other languages using text.
Okay,
so block coding is usually used with kids who are learning how to code and not really used in the professional industry. In some cases, it still is, but in most cases, professionals prefer to use typing. But why is that the case? So there are many reasons. I mentioned a few. Oh, I'm gonna stop this. Okay. It would have dinged at me if I did not press the little stop button. So one of the most frustrating things with programming, with block coding, is that it takes a long time to find and drag the blocks, as I mentioned while doing the little demo follow along, whichever you call it. So that is one frustrating thing that takes up a lot of time. Now, this is just for a simple sorting hack code. Now, think about a code for an entire app or a robot. If it were all block coding, ooh my goodness. Okay, so with block coding, we are limited to what the blocks say. The code looks very long vertically and takes up a lot of space. It's kind of scattered everywhere. It's not very efficient, as we might call it. The good thing about it is you don't have to worry about things like spelling mistakes, typos, things like that, because all of that is already done for you. You just have to put in the right blocks together and it'll do what you want. So, yeah, for those reasons and a bunch more, professional developers prefer to use a programming language such as JavaScript. So, what is efficient coding and why do we want it? So, efficient coding refers to code that is clean, organized, short, and uses as few variables or as few lines as possible. It makes the code a lot easier to understand if you're explaining it to someone else, and easier to troubleshoot if something is not working the way you expect it to. In addition to that, it makes the code easier to change if you want to change something in the end. Okay, so as we can see, this code, while it does look pretty, it's not the most efficient. So there are a lot of repeated things that we see over here, but how might we be able to shorten it? So if you already have experience with JavaScript, feel free to just shorten the code, make it more efficient as you can. But I will be explaining how we can do certain things to make this code a bit more efficient.
Okay, so before I start editing all my code in JavaScript, I'm just gonna scroll around and see if there's any pieces of code that I might want to just get rid of. So this forever block is not being used. I can just delete that. You know what? This, even though it was nice to have, was a bit unnecessary. I'm gonna delete that since I now have my little play sound to tell me when the color is chosen. So, I think that should be good. Okay, so I'm gonna switch over to JavaScript. Okay, so there's this huge chunk and it doesn't look very efficient because, well, we see a lot of repetition in our code. Over here, we see the same for loop with the same, everything is exactly the same. The only difference is this color code over here. So it's the RGB color code. It's a hex code, so it's written in hexadecimal. So one thing that I can do is I can make an array. So if I make an array over here, so an array is basically a list. It can be a list of numbers, a list of strings, a lot of different things. So
So over here, I'm going to make a list of numbers. As I said, these are hexadecimal numbers. So I'm just going to be putting in my four Hogwarts house colors. So that'll be these ones here. Put them in, separated by a comma. And there we go. Okay. Now, something else I might want to do is, instead of having all of these for loops, I can now use just two for loops and have one nested inside the other. Oh, I just realized I had changed it to 200, which is longer than 100. I meant to change it to, let's do it to 50. That's shorter. But that wasn't very important. Don't mind it. Okay. So I am going to make, let's just put it over here, a for loop. And I'm going to put in a new index called house index. Okay, so this will be the index we use to cycle through the color codes. 0, and less than or equal to 3. House index plus plus. So I'll explain this code in a bit more detail later during the second part of the program today, but for now I'll just show you how I can use parts of my code and parts of what I've already said to make this code look more efficient. Okay, so now I have something for the house index. What I can do now is I can get rid of all of these, but keep one of them, and I'm just gonna cut and paste that into this for loop. Okay. And let's see, need to change this color code over here. So since I made that array with my color codes, I can now make use of the array. So color codes, that's my array, and I'm going to reference one of these numbers, which is going to be house index. Okay, I really hope I did this right, otherwise that'd be really sad. Let's take a look. It seems like it is functioning. Yay! So now we have simplified the spinning lights function. So there are other things you can do to simplify the code over here in the part where you shook and everything, but there we go. If you look over here now, our function is so much shorter. So if you have the time, I would encourage you to try to shorten the code for the onShake gesture. I think it should probably be able to shorten to probably around the same length as the spinning lights function. Give it a try. Okay. Yeah. Also, just feel free to customize your code a lot more, and so forth. So, if you want to take a break, now would be a good time, as I will be starting the next activity, which will be on a different website. But feel free to stay on the Adafruit stuff and just play with it more.
or move on. Up to you. So, what is JavaScript? I've been talking about how it is coding language, but how does it work and everything? So, JavaScript is a scripting language. It's used to program all sorts of things like apps, websites, robots, so much more. But the main thing about it is that it can't run on its own. So it needs to be run on a browser and is often used in conjunction with HTML and CSS. For the most part, it's the part of the code that creates functionality. So if you were to build a website, this is the part where you would add buttons, animations, things like that. Okay. It is similar to the C and C++ programming languages, if you are familiar with those. That's also what you would use for Arduino, if you've seen those or played with those. Okay, so one very important note, we're not making a website today. We're learning some basics of JavaScript and applying our knowledge to some challenges. Okay, just wanted to put that out of the way, since I mentioned websites, that we are not building a website. Okay, so how does JavaScript work? Programming in general, we use something called an integrated development environment, or an IDE. So this IDE would have a source code editor. It is able to help you find bugs or errors in your code and test out individual or all parts of your code. So basically, when programmers write their code, they write the code, they test, they edit, and they repeat. They use something called a console. And it's honestly my favorite part of programming because it lets you test your code. So there's part of it that will tell you if there's an error in your code. It will show you like spelling errors or if your syntax is wrong. If you have a variable that was undeclared, it'll let you know. And yeah. Okay. So. For today, we're going to be using an IDE on Playcode. It is very similar to what a lot of programmers use, but it is a lot more simplified. It does have a console, and that is what we're going to be using to test out whether or not the codes we're practicing with are working. So you're going to go to this website, https://playcode.io. You can sign in if you have an account already, or you can make a free account. You can use it without an account, but it will have delays every 30 seconds, which can be a little bit frustrating. But if you don't want to make an account and you are patient, sure, why not? Once you open it, you will create an empty template, and then in a new tab, go to this link over here, and copy and paste its contents into the script.js tab. So this link is case sensitive, but yeah. Okay, and let's go. Okay, so this here is the website when you just get onto it. You might have to click on Open Editor, but you should see a page that looks something like this. And this block over here, you're going to click on Empty. We don't want to use that fancy template over there. And I already have my stuff copied, so I'll just paste it all over here. And that's in the wrong tab. Wow. Okay, so we're gonna go to the script.js and paste it here. Okay, and also we don't need the result view because we're just going to be testing things out with the console. Feel free to adjust your page as you see need. So I'm just gonna move that over so I can see all of my code. So over here, it's a little bit strange at first because you might want to save this so that you can work on it again later, but it doesn't let you save it immediately. You have to click clone and then it saves it, and then it'll save it as clone empty and you can rename it. But it's just a little weird quirk of this website. So, this is a JavaScript tutorial that I have made, and welcome. So,
as I mentioned, computers read code. I'm pretty sure I mentioned, but computers will read every single line of code that is there unless you comment it out. So as here you can see, this is a comment. So anything with two slashes at the front is a comment. The computer will stop reading anything that shows up after it as long as it's on the same line. To uncomment anything, you can just highlight and press Control L. If you're on a MacBook, I believe that'd be Command, not L, slash. If you're on a MacBook, I believe that's Command slash, but I'm not too sure. And also, just an important note on this tutorial, please recomment any program code you uncommented or wrote after finishing each tutorial section, just so that they don't interfere with one another. So, the very first part is easy. Just try uncommenting the following code. So I'm sure you can do this yourself. Just want to do control slash, and you'll see, oh, now in your console it says, hello world. Okay, and now over here, this is another example of how things can be commented out. So this allows you to comment out multiple lines of code. So instead of having the two slashes at the beginning, I could just type random stuff here and it will just automatically be commented out. Okay. Now, as I mentioned earlier, JavaScript runs on a browser. So that means we can take advantage of something called pop-up prompts. There we go. I can use words. So pop-up prompts. They are a little bit annoying sometimes when you don't want them to show up, but we're programming something, so it's okay. These aren't going to be pop-ups like ads. They're just little text boxes where you enter something in. Okay, so it basically allows you to input information, but you have to make sure that you store that information into a variable or else it just gets lost. Okay, so let's uncomment this code over here and see what happens. Since I have the live button switched on, it just automatically runs the code and asks, what is your name? Okay, I don't remember if I introduced myself, but my name is Megan. Okay, and now it displays my name here. I'm gonna undo the live button because I don't want it to automatically pop out windows every time I type a letter. So right now, looking at this code over here, I have a variable which stores the information that I get from my window prompt. Okay. So this over here is just what will display in the prompt, which is my question, what is your name? It doesn't matter what you type in here as long as it is within the quotation marks. And then console log. So console.log. This is what enables you to write directly to the console over here. Whatever you put into the brackets will appear. So if you want to put in a variable, you just put in the name of the variable. If you want to put in actual words, let's say, hello. Oh, right now it'll still ask me for my name. It'll say hello in the console instead. Alright, so comment that back out. Now, up next, something very important to know, data types. I mentioned some of these earlier. So strings are a series of characters, symbols, words, or numbers. When I say a string can be a series of numbers, it can also include spaces, so it can be a whole bunch of separate numbers or a big number. It's a little bit complicated. We don't need to know too much about it for now, but that's okay. Numbers, they are a numerical value. So like 1, 2, 3, 4, not F-O-U-R, but just the number 4. That is very important to know. Okay, and a Boolean, that is something that is either true or false. So when we say true or false, in computer, that means either 1 or 0. So it's like a yes or no type of thing. And then an array, as I mentioned, is a list of strings or numbers that you can access using indices, and it starts with 0. So over here, if I uncomment this, in my console I have shown here, this is how you combine different variables into your console message. Okay, so what is your name? I am Megan. What is your age? I'm not telling you guys my age, so let's just pretend I'm 100, because I am definitely not 100. Okay, and now you see over here, it says, hello everyone, my name is Megan, and I am 100 years old. Pretty cool, right? It looks like it's kind of split on separate lines, but if I just drag my console over, they're actually on the same line. Okay, there we go. Okay, so when we use the console, we are printing strings. Okay, if these variables, even if these variables were numbers, they become strings. It'll make a little more sense in a bit. Okay, yeah, maybe I should have kept that for now. Okay. Let's do that again. Megan, and let's say I'm 0 years old. We see that our age, even though I entered 0, which is a number, is a string. That's because anything we input using the window prompt will turn into a string. Okay, so comparison operators and Boolean operators. We saw some of these already in the block coding, but there are a few that we haven't seen. So instead of just a regular equal sign, we have the double equal sign. This is because if we have just one single equal sign, that is an assign term. So like when we said variable thing equals this, we had to, that was for one equal sign. If we are comparing, we need two. There's also something that is three equal signs, and that means not only is the value equal to, it is also of the same type. So if you had the number 4 as a string and 4 as a number, and you use the two equal signs, they would return true, but if you use the triple equal sign, it would return false. If that does not make sense, it's okay, we don't need to use that for now. Second one is not equal to. So you want to know if two things are different from each other. Less than, greater than, and then less than or equal to, greater than or equal to, I'm pretty sure you understand. And then these Boolean operators here are also very important. So the double ampersand is the double and symbol. It is and. So it returns true if both statements, so the one to the left of it and the one to the right of it, are both true. So if you have on the left side, 1 equals 1 and 2 equals 2, both of those statements are true, it will return true. But if you put 1 equals 0 and 5 equals 10, it'll be like, what are we talking about? Those aren't true. And return false. For or, that means at least one of these statements is true. And then finally, not is just like the exclamation mark we had up there. It just reverses the result, so it just means it's no longer true or no longer false, flipping it around. Okay, so if and for loops. So I've already mentioned if loops and for loops. But if you need further explanations, I can just uncomment the code over here and show you how they work. So right now I have, are you happy today? Answer Y or N. So I can put in Y for yes, and I'll say, yay, I'm happy to hear. So my if statement over here depends on the answer that I submit to it. Since my answer matched the string Y, it will return this. And if I were to do this again and typed in N, this first if statement would have been false, so it would have gone to the else if answer equals equals N. And now that statement is true, so it displays this console message. Aw, I'm sorry to hear that. Hope your day will get better. And if I try that one last time, we will execute that else line by putting in literally anything else. Like, I don't understand your answer. Let's try that again. So it's always nice to have an else statement because you want something to default to in case the input is something that you did not expect. When you are coding, this is something very important to look out for because it might break your code if you have a website that is supposed to calculate, I don't know, turnip prices, if any of you play Animal Crossing. But instead of putting in the price of their turnips for the day, someone decided to put in the word cat. It should not be able to calculate anything based on that, and there needs to be a way to avoid that from happening. So just keep that in mind when you are doing code. Okay. And for loops. So I mentioned the for loops, but I did not really explain what they do or how they are made. So for loops, they do a repeated task and they use an index or counter to keep track. So I have the first term is initialization, which is where you set up initial values of any counters, indices, or other variables. In a lot of cases, this would be setting it to 0, but sometimes it'll be setting it to 1. I realize that in my video, I do not have an example. I apologize. I will add an example into the document so that when you are doing this on your own, you should have an example over there that you can uncomment and see it in action. Okay. And last but not least, an array. So as I mentioned before, an array is a list of numbers, strings, anything you want it to be. Okay, so, oh, never mind, I do have an example of a for loop. What am I saying? Okay, so this over here, I have a for loop that has my index initialized to 0. And so as long as my index is less than or equal to 4, this is the condition that it will check. So when it's checking this condition, it will see if it's true. If it is true, it will continue its task, which is to run the line or lines of code over here. But if it is false, it will just leave the for loop and get out. And this third term over here is incrementation. So you can use plus plus to increase the value by 1, or you could use minus minus to decrease it. So this section of code will run at the end after anything inside the curly brackets has been run, but before it checks this statement again. So if I run this program right now, it will display 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, which is all the numbers I put in this array. Okay, so that basically concludes this tutorial over here. I hope I was able to explain things decently clearly. But if you're ready to move on, it is time to do some challenges. Okay, so this part is for students who want to try out more things with JavaScript. If you are comfortable with what I just went over, or if you want to try out more things related to it, you're eager about it, this is the thing to do. If you didn't quite like it and don't really want to continue doing it, that is okay. Programming can be confusing at first, might make more sense later when you look back at it. Different for everyone. Okay, so these challenges have varying difficulties and are self-guided. So, like before, you can copy and paste the contents from this other file into the JavaScript tab. You might want to open up a new empty project to do this so that you can work on it separately, but these links are also just there so you can copy and paste it whenever you want. I do have this solutions file. They are not the only solutions for these challenges, so always try other ways to do them. And another note is that these files may be updated in the future. Maybe. If I have the time, I will try to add more challenges to them and also add more possible solutions. But for now, that's it. Yeah. Okay, so thank you everyone for coming to today's event. I hope you have fun or had fun, learned something, or want to try something new. Yeah, so that concludes our program. I will have some links to extra resources in the description box below. But yeah, stay tuned to our YouTube channel and our website at gearingup.ca for any upcoming news and events. Thanks again. Bye now.